Why would ferritin and B12 increase on a low-calorie keto diet?
Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode. Pippa asks, can you think of a reason why ferritin and serum B12 would increase significantly after 5 days of hypocaloric keto dieting from a baseline of eucaloric keto and then drop again after going hypercaloric keto? Dave Feldman saw this in one of his recent experiments. Ferritin rose from 282 to 346 and then back to 272. So 282 is eucaloric, 346 was hypocaloric. Back to 272 was hypercaloric. B12 went from 912 on eucaloric to 1411 hypocaloric to 816 on hypercaloric. I don't know. I can throw out some guesses, but I don't know how valuable those guesses are. And I certainly don't know how correct they are. So ferritin is very strongly influenced by inflammation and oxidative stress. And so if the iron status is not changing and the ferritin's going up and then down, to me, that suggests that oxidative stress or inflammation is increasing in the hypocaloric state. And that wouldn't surprise me, given the sense that, you know, Feldman's eating, I believe, is eating, these are all keto diets, right? So, I don't know. I was thinking maybe there's more PUFAs and more, you know, stronger favoring of oxidative stress when there's more PUFAs released from adipose tissue. During a hypocaloric state, maybe, I don't know. There could be a thyroid regulation here. Off the top of my head, I'm not sure how thyroid would play into this, but obviously thyroid's going to go down in the hypocaloric state and up in the hypercaloric state. B12 can go up with liver problems sometimes. So it's possible that in this hypocaloric state, the liver's not doing too well. Cause one of the things that happens is, like, if you compare the fed state to the fasting state, in the fasting state, the liver's taking on much more of the brunt of energy metabolism than in the fed state. So think about the keto diet, right? Let's replace his hypocaloric diet with fasting, since fasting is just a more extreme form of a hypocaloric diet. So on a keto diet and on fasting, you're going to be burning a lot of fat. But on the keto diet, your fat is coming in from food. Your fat is bypassing the liver. It's going into the lymph, circulating as chylomicrons. And then every tissue besides the liver gets first dibs on taking up that fat. In fasting, adipose tissue is releasing fatty acids, opposite of the keto diet, right? Adipose tissue is taking up fatty acids in the postprandial state of a keto diet. The fasting state, adipose is releasing fatty acids. Those fatty acids are all going to the liver. They're not going into the lymph and circulating the way in chylomicrons for uptake by other tissues in LPL, the way that postprandial triglycerides from the diet are. So all those fatty acids are going straight to the liver. And the intention is that they'll get beta oxidized there, and they will support the ATP from beta oxidation will be used to support gluconeogenesis. And to the extent there's acetyl-CoA left over, that will be used to form ketones that can then go out and be used by the other tissues. So all the PUFAs are being metabolized in the liver. And so there's probably oxidative stress is increasing in the liver specifically in the hypocaloric diet, because the fatty acids are all being biased towards lipolysis from adipose tissue straight to the liver for beta oxidation. And I think that's dramatically increasing the oxidative burden on the liver. And there's, you know, short-term damage being done in the liver that's increasing the B12 and ferritin levels. That would be my guess. Just a guess, but those are my thoughts. All right. Thanks, Pippi, for your question.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. As a bonus, you also get to participate in monthly private Zoom Q&As with me. You can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled out as Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for a 10% lifetime discount.
From now through February or March, whatever it takes to get it done, I will be working full-time on finishing my Vitamins and Minerals 101 book while reserving a portion of my time for my consulting clients. You can pre-order my book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book.
In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. I will try to respond to comments here when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.